£2,000 in cash, free meals, your own room with Wi-Fi and games. All it takes is a single injection of an experimental drug, which they promise is completely safe. In March 2006, 8 healthy young men arrived at Northwick Park Hospital in London. Within hours, 6 of them would be in intensive care. Their faces and bodies would swell beyond recognition, their organs start to fail, and doctors would fight for every minute of their lives. This is the story of TGN1412, a drug meant to revolutionize the treatment of serious diseases, but that became infamous as one of the world's most terrifying clinical trials. TGN1412 was an experimental drug, part of a class called monoclonal antibodies. In simple terms, monoclonal antibodies are proteins that act like precision-guided missiles. They locate a specific target in the body and either block it or activate it. These drugs have already been used to treat cancers, rheumatoid arthritis, and other serious conditions. But TGN1412 was different. Its target was a protein called CD28, essentially an ignition key for T cells, which control the immune system. The idea was bold: quickly wake up the immune system to attack, for instance, leukemia cells, or reset it in autoimmune diseases. In animal studies, including monkeys, the drug appeared safe and caused no side effects. Researchers believed humans would respond the same way. To understand what went wrong, we need to look at how new drugs are developed. It starts in the lab, where scientists identify a molecule that might affect a specific target in the body. First, it's tested in a test tube and on cells, then in animals. This preclinical stage is critical. It shows how the drug spreads, is metabolized, and, most importantly, whether it's safe. If results are promising, human trials begin. Phase 1 usually involves a small group of healthy volunteers. At this stage, the goal isn't to see if the drug works, it's to ensure it's safe and to observe how the body responds to different doses. This is the riskiest phase. Phase 2 moves to patients to test effectiveness and optimal dosing. Phase 3 involves hundreds or thousands of patients comparing the new drug with existing treatments. Only then do regulators decide if it can be marketed. Even after approval, phase 4 monitoring continues to detect rare or delayed side effects. These stages minimize risk, but no process guarantees absolute safety, especially in phase 1, when a drug meets humans for the first time. And it was here that the tragedy of TGN1412 began. In March 2006, 8 men aged 19 to 34 arrived at Northwick Park. 2 would receive a placebo, harmless saline, and 6 would get TGN1412 at what seemed like a tiny dose, hundreds of times lower than what had been safe in animals. The injections began in the morning, given one by one, about 10 minutes apart. Everything seemed like a standard phase 1 trial. Within an hour, the first volunteers complained of severe headaches and muscle and backaches. Fever, chills, nausea, and vomiting followed almost immediately. One participant later said it felt as if his brain was on fire and his head was swelling from the inside. Another saw his fellow volunteers writhing in pain, vomiting, fainting, scenes that resembled a horror movie. A third described sudden cold sweats, shaking uncontrollably, unable to warm up. The swelling was extreme. One man was nicknamed the Elephant Man for the sheer edema on his face. This was a cytokine storm. The immune system erupted, releasing a flood of inflammatory molecules that attacked the body's own tissues, leading to multiple organ failure. Doctors launched a desperate fight: high-dose steroids, plasma exchange, mechanical ventilation, kidney and heart support. Paradoxically, some types of white blood cells, lymphocytes and monocytes, vital to immunity, almost disappeared amidst the hyperinflammation. Families were told to prepare for the worst. The worst affected was 21-year-old Ryan Wilson. He developed multiple organ failure and spent over 3 months in intensive care. He survived but lost all his toes, part of his foot, and several fingers to gangrene. The others spent weeks in hospital and months recovering. They were warned that long-term effects could appear years later, from chronic inflammation to cancer. Years after the tragedy, former volunteers have given multiple interviews. Many complained of persistent joint pain, chronic fatigue, and problems with memory and concentration. Ryan Wilson, the most severely affected, suffered from phantom limb pain after losing fingers and part of his foot, as well as severe depression. He said he had lost the ability to lead his previously active lifestyle and felt like a prisoner in his own body. Other participants developed autoimmune issues. Their bodies began attacking their own tissues. Doctors couldn't say for certain whether this was caused by TGN1412 or was a coincidence, but all of them shared one thought: they had taken part in a trial that had changed their lives forever. After the high-profile failure, an investigation was launched. It was conducted by the Medicines and Healthcare Products Regulatory Agency, MHRA. According to the reports, no deficiencies were found in Tegenero's preclinical work, nor was there evidence of undisclosed studies. Paraxyl's records and procedures were also in order, including dose measurement and administration. No errors or shortcomings were identified that could have caused contamination or overdose. The MHRA concluded that the company's actions did not contribute to the serious adverse reactions. Investigators found that humans reacted differently to TGN1412 than animals. The drug's target was present on different immune cells, triggering an uncontrollable reaction. All six participants received the injections almost simultaneously. No one waited to see the first reaction, removing any chance to stop the trial early. And although the starting dose seemed safe in animals, it was too high for humans. After this, rules changed. Trials now begin with microdoses, given to one person at a time, with hours or days between injections. But for the TGN1412 participants, it was too late. Their health was already devastated, and the consequences for the company and organizers were catastrophic. For Tegenero, the failure was a fatal blow. The company shut down just months later. Its patents and documentation were sold off to pay creditors. Paraxyl, the contractor that conducted the trial, found itself at the center of the scandal and faced heavy criticism for its handling of the process. Reports noted that the staff were unprepared for an immediate mass reaction and that the clinic lacked sufficient resuscitation equipment. Thus, the developer, Tegenero, went bankrupt. Trial insurance covered only £2 million, a fraction of the potential risk. The trial executor later paid compensation to the victims. Despite the global scandal, a few years later, the rights to TGN1412 were bought by the Russian company Theramab and renamed TAB08. The drug was tested in smaller doses, with cautious protocols, aiming at autoimmune diseases. By the time it neared the market, 8 years had passed. Competitors already had effective alternatives. Interest in TAB08 waned. Results were not fully published, suggesting the effects might have been weak or absent. TAB08 never became a breakthrough drug. TGN1412 became a turning point for the pharmaceutical industry. The European Medicines Agency and regulators worldwide tightened Phase 1 requirements. This case is now studied as a textbook of errors to prevent future tragedies.